In today's video, I'm gonna show you the secret settings of my OBS for 2018. Settings I use to stream to YouTube and Twitch. Let's go to the settings. On the general tab, what is noticeable here is to automatically record when streaming. I have different recording settings from streaming settings. Actually, my local recording has a higher quality than the stream. And so if I want to make another video after the stream, I use that locally recorded video for that. And that's why I have this option selected here whenever I start the stream. The stream is also recorded automatically. It's basically so that I don't forget. You could also start it later, but I have this in automatic so I don't forget. On the stream tab, basically select the streaming service. We're not gonna go into the details. Here is Twitch, and then you enter your stream key, and that's it for the stream. Let's go into the beef, which is on the output tab. For the encoder, I'm using the NVENC, which is the graphics card, basically encoding the video, not the software X264. I'm using the hardware, I'm using the graphics card to encode. Then I use the Inforce streaming service encoder settings, and here, rescale output to 720p, which is 1280x720. Why do I rescale? Because on the base canvas over here, my base canvas is 1080p, which is 1920x1080. That's my base canvas, and it's 60 frames per second. If you struggle because the bandwidth you need is too big, or your stream struggles with the quality, this is the first thing you want to change. Lower this to 30 frames per second instead of 60 frames per second. So my base canvas, 1080p. That's why on my streaming settings, I downscale it here to 720p. Then for the rate control, always use CBR, which means constant bitrate, because some streaming servers struggle to handle if it's not constant bitrate. I set the bitrate to 3500. If you still struggle with that, you can lower it to 3000 or even to 2500, but then 2500 is certainly not enough for 60 frames per second. So you should lower the frames per second first if they're on 60. Lower them to 30. Otherwise, 3500 is actually a good spot. It's not too much and it's not too little. It's really a good spot. What is really important is the keyframe interval. The keyframe interval tells the stream to send a keyframe every 2 seconds. That is very important for YouTube to sync the stream, because otherwise there may be delays, it may be too slow and stuff. YouTube will just have trouble if you're not sending a keyframe every 2 seconds. So I really recommend this on 2 seconds, not on zero. My preset is high quality, high level is auto, and yeah, that's just it. On the recording tab, first thing to note here is I'm recording in MKV format, MKV container format, and not MP4. The reason for that is you can basically choose both, but the reason for that is MKV, if your stream crashes, the MKV is still usable, readable. You can still convert it to an MP4. If you're recording MP4 and your stream crashes, your video file will be corrupt. You will not be able to use your recorded video file if the stream crashes. Therefore, especially for a long live stream that you're recording the whole stream, always I recommend to use MKV, because then you're safe, you're not gonna lose your work. Then the next thing notable here is I'm recording 4 audio tracks. Now this only makes sense if you have a video editing software that is able to separate different audio tracks and handle them differently, like mute one of the tracks or increase volumes of individual tracks. I'm using Final Cut Pro, that's why this is possible. And what it basically means, the audio track number one, that's the stream. So basically all of the audio tracks, like desktop audio, microphone, everything is going to audio track number one. It's everything. Audio track number two is just the microphone. Audio track number three is the desktop audio. Like if I'm playing music, this goes to track number three. And audio track number 4 is the Elgato. It may actually be the other way around, 3 and 4. We'll see later in the video. Then the encoder is the same. And what is also different here and noticeable, I don't rescale. So for recording, I record the full 1080p. And because that puts more strain on the video, it needs a higher bitrate. And that's 4,500 here for the recording. And the rest, basically the same thing here on recording. On the audio tab, everything is on 192. And then the replay buffer, you can switch it off if you don't like it. But if you're not recording, it may be a good thing. Having it on 600 seconds, which is 10 minutes. That means when I start the replay buffer, and then I game and stream and so on, and then something incredible happens, I just save the replay buffer and the last 10 minutes will be saved. That's what the replay buffer is for. That also puts more strain on your graphics unit. So if your stream gets laggy, that may also be one of the reasons why it gets laggy. Then let's go to the audio tab. On the audio tab, the desktop audio service, here it's showing it's not connected. That would usually be my headphones because I'm recording the audio from the headphones usually because I'm listening to the stream on the headphones. You would just select the headphones here. My desktop audio too is actually the speakers. So I'm also able to record the speakers. But since I fear that the speakers interfere with the microphone, I'm usually having it on the headphones. Then microphone is my EAD microphone here selected. And that's it for audio. And video, we have already seen. In the hotkeys, I set the replay buffer, save replay, to Ctrl-Shift-S. That's what I use to save the replay buffer, Ctrl-Shift-S. That's what's in the settings, but that's not all. The next thing we're gonna go to is all the audio settings. And I switch the overlay here so that we're also able to see the Elgato settings. Usually there would be the Elgato, and I want to show you those settings too. So let's start here with the advanced audio properties. Very interesting thing up here. What you see here is I put my Elgato volume to 15. We get to that a little bit later. There's different options for this. And yeah, the reason why is basically because I'm recording my Elgato on a different track. You see it here, it's on track number 4. And it's not going to 1, which is basically what is streamed. But that's not true because I selected monitor and output, which basically means it's also gonna go to the desktop audio automatically. That's how I set it up here for the Elgato. Now, if you don't want it on a separate track, you would change your settings in the Elgato. I will show that in a second. And then you just select 1 here and your full Elgato would just go to 1 and you would have it on monitor off right here. Then my face cam is not recording anything because I'm using the microphone for audio. Then my microphone is, this is important here, the sync offset is 80. This basically tells that my microphone is 80 milliseconds behind the webcam. And you gotta find that out yourself how much it is, but otherwise they are not in sync. And my mouth would move faster or like 80 milliseconds earlier than the audio you hear. And so I kind of shift the audio here from the microphone 80 milliseconds so that the face and the voice are in sync. And then here you see the microphone is going to the stream and is recording on audio track number 2. Then I have the desktop audios 1 and 2. They're both going to the stream here on 1 and they're recorded on 3. The Elgato, by the way, recorded on 4. That's what's in the advanced audio properties. Now let's quickly go to the microphone settings. On the microphone filters, I'm not gonna read them out. You can just halt the video and look at those. These are the settings I'm using for the compressor, and these are the settings I'm using for the noise gate. Then what I'm using for the Elgato, I just talked about that. Let's go to the Elgato properties. Here are my Elgato settings. I'm capturing it in 1080p here in the resolution. The FPS will match my output FPS. That means if I'm 30 frames, it will be 30 frames. If I'm 60 frames per second, the Elgato will also be 60 frames per second. Now, what is important here, I have it on capture audio only. And that's where I said this ensures it only captures the audio in OBS and then puts it where I want it. And that is, it puts it to track number 4. And because I have that monitoring switch there, it will also put it on the desktop in the settings that I've shown you before. Now, if I don't want it on a separate audio track, I would just select desktop audio, one of those two here, and then it's just output to the desktop audio. It's part of, it's on the same track as the music and everything else. It's not separate. I actually had this setting for quite a while, and then I found out how to separate the Elgato to a different audio track. Now, let's jump into 1080p. So on my 1080p profile, everything's the same, of course. General stream, that's all the same. But on the output, you will see a difference here. The output is not rescaled because my base canvas is 1080p. I'm not downscaling it here to 720p, but it's a 1080p stream. It's more strained to your processor, to your computer, so be very careful to go 1080p and not 720p. And also it needs more bitrate, especially with 60 frames per second. I found that 4500 is actually a good value here for the bitrate. And you may remember now, this is actually the same bitrate I have on recording. So now recording is the same as streaming on my 1080p profile. And that's why in encoder, I just have use stream encoder, which basically says, just copy the stream and put that on the disk, but with the 4 audio tracks. Very easy. So I hope this video helps you with configuring your OBS settings. There is a regular how to live stream, how to build your gaming channel video here. So if you don't want to miss anything, make sure to subscribe to my channel. Click the little bell for notifications. See you in the next video. Bye. We'll be right back.